Good morning. Let us be called to worship. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The Spirit of God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light." And God saw that it was good. At the beginning of his ministry, Jesus was baptized by John. The heavens opened, and the Spirit descended like a dove. Then God said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Let us worship God, Creator, Redeemer, Inspirer." Let us be called to confession. We have been created in goodness by a loving God, yet our thoughts, activities, and behaviors are sometimes far from that goodness. We return to the waters of baptism daily to repent, to be cleansed, to be renewed. Friends, please join me in prayer to confess our failings and receive what we need. Let us pray. God of all glory, you look from heaven and see us as we are, created by you in goodness for goodness. Yet all too often we are too proud to kneel before you. All too often we are not ready to welcome your way. All too often our stubbornness keeps us from surrendering to your will for our lives and for all creation. Forgive us, gracious God. In Christ, stoop down to save us. Loosen the ties that bind us to sin and set us free to love and serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. May we be assured of God's grace. Hear the good news of the gospel. As a voice from heaven said to Jesus, so God says to each of us, "You are my beloved child, and with you I am well pleased." In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Today's scripture is taken from Mark 1, 4 through 11, from the Common English Bible. John the Baptist was in the wilderness calling for people to be baptized to show that they were changing their hearts and lives and wanted God to forgive their sins. Everyone in Judea and all the people of Jerusalem went out to the Jordan River and were being baptized by John as they confessed their sins. John wore clothes made of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey. He announced, "One stronger than I am is coming after me. I'm not even worthy to bend over and loosen the strap of his sandals. I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." About that time, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and John baptized him in the Jordan River. While he was coming up out of the water, Jesus saw heaven splitting open and the Spirit, like a dove, coming down on him. And there was a voice from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I dearly love. In you I find happiness."
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, wherever you are and however you are, welcome to a time of worship on behalf of the people and leadership of First Presbyterian Churches Essex and Shenandoah, Iowa. I want to invite you into a space of holiness, healing, renewal, a time and a space where we can offer ourselves to God together apart, and receive blessing from God together apart. My hope is that in this time together, in this time of worship, you might know that you have been in the presence of God and the difference that that can make in a person's life. For months, some of us have felt like a tiny fish on a big ocean in a small bubble. It's reminded me of an insightful scene from the end of the animated movie, Finding Nemo. If you haven't seen Finding Nemo, it's worth the time, because Finding Nemo is a story about the journey of life and the journey of faith, because those two stories and those two journeys are always intertwined. But it's also a story not just about finding Nemo, but how many of the characters in the movie find a new meaning in life. And that's always a great story, isn't it? A tropical clownfish by the name of Marlin is separated from his young son Nemo when Nemo is caught by a diver looking for tropical fish to sell and eventually winds up in a dentist office aquarium in Sydney, Australia. To make a long story short, father goes on a quest to find son. Father and son are miraculously reunited through the help of some wild, quirky characters in the story. Because you know, life and faith are filled with wild, quirky characters, right? Nobody in this story goes through the story all by themselves. They can't. But even as that story of reunion and joy comes to a close, that story, that part of the plot line comes to a close, as with life and faith and the search for meaning, another story, another plot line is unfolding. Some of the fish that Nemo shared the aquarium with have themselves managed to escape. With great effort, they rolled the plastic bags that they were being kept in while the aquarium was being cleaned all the way across the counter, through an open window, down across a busy street, and finally landed in the ocean, the harbor of Sydney. When the last fish finally plops down into the water, they share a cheer of victory. And they start congratulating each other on making that perilous escape. So there they are, in the ocean, bobbing up and down on top of the water, and it dawns on them that they're staring at each other through the plastic bags that they're still in. One of the fish, Bloat, a puffer fish, articulates what everyone else is thinking. Now what? And then they roll the credits to the movie, to the sound of Bobby Darin singing Somewhere Across the Sea. Now what? It's a great question, isn't it? It's not only a question for our time, it's a question for every time. Now what? And that question keeps resurfacing at different times in our life, in different phases of our lives, at different points in our lives, and in a real sense, on every day of our lives. Now what? Given everything that we've been through up till now, things that we can't undo, now what? We've come through quite a few challenges, quite a few perils. We've come through a time where we've made some discoveries and we've made some achievements and we've had some learnings. We've come through a time where there have been some real heartbreaks and anxiety. And we have come through a time where each of us, to some degree, have wondered, not only how are we going to get through this, but what are we going to do now? With one part of the storyline coming to an end, and another part of the storyline beginning to unfold, how do we move forward from here? Because the answer to that question will, in large part, determine the shape of tomorrow. Now what? In response to that ever-relevant question, the author of the Gospel of Mark would offer us a helpful suggestion, namely that now would be a great time to look at the baptism of Jesus and to consequently reflect on our own baptisms and remember our own baptisms and the implications of that for our time and our place. That's how Mark began the story of Jesus, with the credits rolling from everything that had taken place in the life and faith of the people of Israel, culminating in the character of John the Baptist, to a new story, a new storyline, a new plot unfolding in the life of Jesus. Mark tells us that another story is just beginning, and it is an important adventure because it's one that we ourselves are caught up in. It's our story too, even now. And how appropriate that the story begins in water. In Mark's gospel, we don't get a nativity. We don't get angels and shepherds. We don't get the Holy Family at the manger. We don't get the Magi. We don't get any of that. In Mark's story of Jesus, by the time we catch up with Jesus, he is a grown man. And he is in line with ordinary, everyday folk. Jesus shows up for the first time in a line to be baptized by the wild and woolly character John the Baptist, who is out in the wilderness getting people ready for the next chapter, getting people ready for the next part of the story, the next thing that God is going to do in and for the life of the world. John is convinced that this is a really important time. And his life mission is to make sure that people know about it. So people from all over the place are coming out to John in the wilderness for a good washing and to be pointed in a new and different direction. to be reoriented to God through a symbolic baptism. And I think it's really important that we notice that Jesus is in line with the rest of us. That may not make sense at first, because you would think, well, Jesus really isn't like us. Why would Jesus need a good washing? Why would Jesus need to be reoriented to God? And it's a part of Mark's message that Jesus really is one of us. That God really has come to be one of us, immersed in our world, in our situation, in our circumstances, with some of the same questions that we face on our journey of life, on our journey of faith, on our journey to find meaning in life. Jesus comes among us as one of us, with all the other folk who are not only wondering, now what, but anticipating that God is up to something good, that God is up to something right, that God is up to something life-giving in what's taking place among us right now. When Jesus is baptized, Mark tells us that the heavens were split open. The word comes from schizo. That's the Greek word, schizo. Something being torn apart. It's where we get the term schizophrenia. Something torn apart. The heavens are torn apart. That barrier between God and humanity is being torn in two without the separation. And we're told that the Holy Spirit descends through that tear in the cosmos and lands on Jesus. Now, at this point, I want to talk just a second about sacrament. A sacrament is a visible sign of something invisible that God is making effective. It's a visible sign of something powerful and life-giving and effective that God is doing. You can't see the power of God at work in someone's life except through the difference that it makes in their lives, right? What you see is the difference that it makes in how they act and what they do. A sacrament is something visible that points to something invisible that God is up to. In this case, the waters of baptism. In this case, that metaphor, that image of a dove coming down. Now, it doesn't just land on Jesus. In the Greek, there's a tiny little word, E-I-S, eis, is the way they pronounce it. And what it means is into. The Holy Spirit doesn't just land on Jesus and sit on top of his head. The Holy Spirit infuses Jesus, comes into him, empowers him. And from that moment on, he's a person on a mission. From that moment on, he's living out the meaning of a new identity. And the identity is also something that we get in the story of Jesus' baptism. This voice comes from heaven. Who knows who heard it? We hear it when we are a part of the story. You are my beloved. You are so special to me. You are my beloved, and I am delighted in you. Wouldn't you want every person in the world to hear that? Wouldn't you want every person in the world to know that deep in their bones, deep in their heart? And what kind of difference would it make in the life of a person if they knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that they were loved unconditionally, deeply, inseparably by God? And that God was delighted in them. That's what God does in this baptism story. And here's what Jesus does. Jesus shares the same faith in God that he is given with us in baptism. Jesus imparts the faith that he has to us in baptism. It comes into him, and through him it moves out into us, so that we too are empowered, infused with that same faith, that same spirit. We too are people on a mission, living out the meaning of our identity that we get from him in baptism. Now what? Well, now we move forward from where we are, given everything that's happened, living out the identity of our baptism. Every day becomes a living out of our baptism, our identity, our purpose, the meaning that we find in knowing who we are in God and whose we are in God. Orthodox theologian Alexander Schmemann says that the faith of Christ is visible in the world through the church. The life of Christ is visible in the world through the church, through you, through me, through us together. So it turns out, we're not fish in a bubble. We're not fish in a baggie. We've been liberated. Liberated to live out the adventure of faith. The adventure of who we are in Jesus in the big, wide ocean of everyday life. A story of discovery and meaning. A story of making our own difference in the world through who we've made to be, who we've been made to be by God. One commentator put it this way: baptism opens our hearts and our minds to becoming instruments that bring unity and peace to our neighborhoods. Unity and peace to our neighborhoods. We can look back on not only all that we've been through in the past year, that message of unity and peace speaks to the events of this past week, doesn't it? You'd have to be on a different planet to not be aware of everything that's taken place in our life together as a nation in the past week. Now more than ever, our nation, our neighborhoods, our cities, our communities need to be filled with people that have as their mission unity and peace. But that's not an easy task, because peace doesn't necessarily just mean the absence of conflict. And unity is certainly not the same as everybody being the same. We're never going to all be the same. But our baptismal identity enables us, with the power of the Spirit in us, with the power of the same faith that Jesus had in God, to seek ways that make for unity and peace among us. We may share the same country, we may share the same neighborhoods, we may share the same cities, but it will require hard work to make those places places of unity and peace. But that is a part of the answer to now what, isn't it? Now what? Well, now we continue to live out our baptismal identity. Now, moving forward from everything that's happened, from where we are now, we live as beloved children of God, in whom God delights, and for whom God has a purpose. But I have to be honest with you, friends. Baptism should come with a warning label. You know how certain products or certain tools or certain things come with a warning label. Even toys come with a warning label, for crying out loud. Don't give this to a child under 3 years old. Baptism should come with a kind of a warning label that gives us a response to now what, but living like Jesus day in and day out is going to cost us something. There's no question about it. Living day in and day out like Jesus costs Jesus something. Once he began living out that mission and that identity that was given by God, in Mark's gospel, do you want to know how long it takes Jesus to get into trouble? The second chapter. We're in chapter one. By chapter two, Jesus is making outsiders insiders. And the insiders don't like that the outsiders have become insiders. And they begin to question his motives. They begin to question everything about him. It isn't long before Jesus is not just a fish in water, he's a fish in hot water, because of who he understands himself to be and because of his vision, which is God's vision for everyone. It will cost us something. Well, the question then becomes, is it worth it? And I imagine Jesus answering with, yes, because it gives us a way to live into the now what of life. It's the gift and adventure of a genuine lifetime. Thanks be to God. Friends, I invite you to join your hearts and minds and spirits together with me in a word of prayer. God, you are the giver of our life. And you are the one who gives us all the gifts that we need to make our life good. You are the one who walks alongside us. In Jesus, you are the one who lives in us in the Spirit. You are the one who joins us together on this journey of life and faith and meaning. Hear us as we pray. And God, give us strength for the living of our days. We pray for the world that you've made. This world where all of creation began with light and water. Help us, God, to be better stewards and less careless of this good world, this earth that you've given us. We pray for the church that you continue to call into being and equip to be the body of Christ in the world. Renew us with the gift of your Spirit and call to Christian discipleship where history and heresy have divided us. Make us one in the baptism we share. Give us strength, God, for the living of our days. We pray, God, for the people that you have created. Give to the leaders of all nations the wisdom to know what is good. Where people are poor and hungry, provide justice and daily bread. Enable us, God, to see light. Enable us, God, to live into the light. Help us, God, to be channels of peace and grace and goodness in our time and place where you have put us. We pray, God, that you will help us as a nation to find a way forward together. Give us strength for the living of our days. We pray for the loved ones that you've given us. Bless our families, our friends, and our neighbors. Keep them safe from trouble and danger. God, where there is sorrow, where there is sickness, where there is suffering, send your Spirit of comfort and healing. Give us strength, O God, for the living of our days. All this we pray and lift up and entrust to you in the name of the Lord Jesus, whose voice is our strength and salvation, whose breath is our spirit of peace, and the one who continues to teach us together to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, go from this place in peace, as those who have heard good news and who have good news to share. Go from this place as those who know that their life is caught up in a big story, a story of life, a story of faith, a story that holds within it deep and great meaning. If you are in a place of challenge or peril now, take heart. If you are in a place of deep anxiety, wondering what in the world is next, take heart. In our baptisms, we are empowered to move forward in the Spirit of Christ. May the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the friendship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you, both now and forever. And the people of God said, Amen. Thank you. both now and always. And the people of God said, Amen.